In this video, we're going to go through collections within Kotlin. A collection is a way that you can categorize like data and do some operations on it. There are three built-in types of collections in Kotlin. There are lists, sets, and maps. We're going to cover all three of those today, in addition to what are called mutable versus read-only variants of those collections, and some of the things you can do with each of them. Let's dive right into it and open up IntelliJ. Let's first start with lists. A list is an ordered collection of items. So think of a list of strings, a list of integers, something like that. Let's create a list. We'll call it my list, and we'll set it equal to list of. The list of function is a useful function that takes in the constituents of the list you want to create and then returns a list out of them. So we talked about in Kotlin, you don't have to explicitly define the type, but in this case, if you wanted to, this is what that would look like. So you're making a list of strings here, and this list of function is what returns the actual list back out of the constituents listed here. If I print out my list, we see our list printed out with the beginning and the end denoted by these brackets here. Okay, so now that we have a list, what are some things we can do with it? Well, one of the most common things is that lists are ordered, which means that you can, what's called, index into them. And Kotlin, like a lot of other languages, has zero-based indexing, which means that if I want to get the first element of the list, I want to use index 0. So when I use this syntax here, that's indicating that I want to index into the 0th element. So this should print 1. And as we can see when we run it, this prints the string 1. I could likewise use something outside of the range, and we'll see how Kotlin handles that. All right, so since I'm using a JVM backing, we can see that the Kotlin call ends up going into ArrayList.get, which has this array index out of bounds exception thrown. So if you're familiar with Java, that should be no surprise to you as far as how Kotlin would handle that. All right, so what else can we do with this list? So let's say I want to append a new item or I want to add something. Add last, add first. Okay, so I don't think this is what I'm looking for. And this gets into a detail of Kotlin, which I think is great. And that is lists are by default read only. So I can't actually modify the list. But if I do want to modify the list, I can do a mutable list of. And now I don't want to define the type anymore. So now I can say my list dot add, and then I want to add element 4. And I can say my list dot remove at index 2. And then if I print out my list, we can see that we added 4 at the end and we removed index 2, which meant 0, 1, 2. So we move the string 3 here and we get 1, 2, and 4. All right, cool. So what are some other things that you can do with a list? Well, you can get its size. You could either use the size property or you can use the count function. They're semantically equivalent. If you look at how count is defined, it just looks at size. You can also sort your list, or you can get something like the first element or the last element of your list. All in all, quite a few useful things you can do with a list. But one other thing that I find really useful about Kotlin is, let's say that I want to pass this list as a read-only list to somebody else. I'm just call this read-only equals my list. So currently, this would still be a mutable list. But instead, if I want to do something like this, now my read-only variable represents a read-only version of the mutable list my list. So think of a function where you're adding something to your list and then you pass it to another function and you don't want that function to change your list. This is a really cool thing built into the language that you should use quite often. And this is different from var and val because var and val point to the actual values that the variables here point to. So this is still a var, even though the list that it's pointing to is read-only, because I can change the value of the read-only variable without actually changing the underlying list here because I'm not changing the list. I could just as easily make these vals, just like how I can make a mutable list of val and it still works properly. And one other thing I want to mention is, let's say we start out with a read-only list and we try to convert it into a mutable list. That's not going to work. And the reason is because the original list is read-only. And if you try to grab a mutable version of something that's read-only, that's not allowed versus going mutable to read-only. So bottom line, make sure that you're using mutable versus read-only properly. And those are distinct from var and val. So now that we've talked about lists, let's talk about a set. So a set, unlike a list, is unordered, and it also doesn't allow duplicates. It is unique values. So I'm going to say var my set, and you guessed it, you can use the set of function to return a set. So let's say I want to do something like this, and then I print out my set. So I would expect that it's only going to be 1, 2 because I have two strings which are equal here. And as expected, we've got 1 and 2 here. The size and the count would both return 2 rather than 3 here, even though this was constructed with 3 different elements within it. And then another thing is, since sets are not ordered, I cannot index into them. So if I try to do something like this, IntelliJ is giving me this warning here because this indexing is not allowed for sets. Something that is done a lot more often on a set is you might want to see if an element is within a set. So I can ask, is the string 1 in my set? And this will return a Boolean true or false. So this should return true. All right, and the in keyword here, this will indicate true or false if the string is within the set here. And in this case, true, it is in there. And then if I change this to something like X here, then we would get false, like you can see right here. An equivalent check that you could do is you could do my set.contains X. And this is essentially the same check where you return the Boolean false if the set does not contain the element. And if it does, then you would return true. Just like lists, you can make a mutable set of, like so. So now with a mutable set, you can add, you can clear, you can remove. Most people use lists when they have to choose between a list and a set, but the nice thing about a set is that it doesn't allow duplicates, which sometimes you want to avoid with a list. So I would say that 9 times out of 10, when I'm choosing a collection type like this to use, I'll use a list. But every once in a while, I might use a set if the need arises. All right, and the last one here is map. A map you can think of as a key value pair, where you've got a unique set of keys, aka a set of keys, and then each key maps to exactly one value. The list of values can be a list because you can have duplicate values, but you cannot have duplicate keys. So let's go ahead and create one. I'm gonna call it my map. I'm gonna use the map of function. And let's go ahead and use integers as keys. So integer value 1. And the syntax here, when I'm mapping a key to a value, is I use the to keyword. And I want to map it to the string 1. So this is a map of size 1 because it has one key of integer value 1 and one value of string 1. If I wanted to make it size 2, I would do this. And you can see, if I print out my map.count, that we get a value of 2 here because we have two keys within our map. So if I want to look at just the keys, I can look at the keys property. And as I mentioned earlier, the keys here is actually a set because you can't have duplicate keys. So that's why we have 1 and 2 listed here. And let's say I want to look at all the values. I can use the values property to do that. And we get the strings 1 and 2 as expected. So let's say that I want to get this string 1 out of the map knowing the key 1. What I can do is I can say index, and this isn't position 1, this is key with value of 1. And this is gonna return this string here for me. Just to make this a little more obvious, I'm going to say hello, and now I can change my key lookup to hello as well. And when I run this, I'm gonna get the same result. So basically, the index operator here looks at the value that you're putting into the index, and it looks into the set of keys that the map has and says, is this a key that I have? Yes, it is. go ahead and give me the corresponding value, which in this case is the value 1. And that's why we print out this 1 right here. So to take this one step further, we could make a val called key and give it a value of hello. And then we could say if key in my map, then we can print out my map at key. And we still get the value that we're looking for here. Let's say that we want to now have a mutable map and we want to modify it. Let's add something. We can do a myMap.put and we could put a key of yo and then a value of haha. Now you'll notice here that IntelliJ is asking me if I really want to use put here, and that's because put returns back the value that was originally pointed to by this key if it already existed. Alternatively, if I don't want to look at the return value here, I can use this slightly shortened syntax and get the same result. So whether you use the assignment operator of a key index or whether you use put, it's kind of a preference thing. The benefit I like of put is that if you have a value you want to check for, you can do that. Versus this way might be more readable for more developers. So we're going to go ahead and use this way for now. And if I print out my map again, we'll see that we get the new key and value here. Oh, and one thing that I did forget to do right here is I really should call this a val. Again, underscoring, there's a difference between calling the variable a val versus making the collection that the variable is using mutable or not. Those are different concepts. So again, you really should be using val wherever possible. And you should be only making things mutable when you know that you need to make them mutable. Otherwise, they should be defaulted to read only. But in this case, that wouldn't allow the code to compile because now I'm doing a mutable operation on a read-only collection. So make sure that you're always careful about that and do what you need to do and don't do what you don't need to do. And that was an overview of the three types of built-in collections within Kotlin: lists, sets, and maps. If you're looking for how to use those types of collections within Java, I'd recommend you check out my video on collections within Java. It's a good overview of some of the things similar to what we covered in this video. As always, thanks for watching. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.